Belinda present this unabridged recording of Fragile Creatures, a memoir, written by Khin Myint and read by Max Brown and Khin Myint. This audiobook contains sensitive themes. If it raises any issues for you, you can contact Lifeline 13 11 14, Beyond Blue 1300 22 4636, or QLife 1800 184 527.
Hello, my name's Khin Myint, and I'm the author of Fragile Creatures, the audiobook that you've chosen to listen to today. Writing this book was my way of reconnecting with the world around me after the events in the story. My favourite part of the writing process was learning more about some of the big social and philosophical quandaries that events in the book point towards. I hope that what you get out of the audiobook is a sense of connection with some of the people in it, whether that's me as the author or other characters that I depict. Perhaps you'll even have a chance to reflect on some of the issues and big ideas that the memoir glances at as the story rolls on. Author's note. This is a work of narrative non-fiction. It's based on subjective memory, like all memoirs. It is as honest as I'm capable of making it. I have changed most names, including those of Rachel and her family. My own family's names remain intact, as do those of public figures. I'm grateful to have a family, small as we are, who have given me their blessing to publish this. This memoir is dedicated to them.
Part 1. 1. I ashed my cigarette and watched the pale ribbon rise below a June blue sky. Mum picked at the other couch's armrest and looked at me. "All I know," she said, "is that your sister didn't ask me." She sighed and I took another drag. My sister had lived the last 13 years with our mother in this duplex, and since shifting back here myself last week, I'd spent most of my time on these outside couches. "It's good that she has to ask someone before she can get it," I said. Mum nodded. The thing we were talking about was a key that opened a box my sister was keeping under her bed. Inside was a drug called Nembutal that she'd ordered from a Mexican website. It had arrived a week earlier and Theda had given the key to her boyfriend, Samuel. The arrangement meant she would need to call him before accessing it, which was wise since my sister didn't want to die. She just wanted an escape hatch nearby. She said it was easier to keep going, knowing that a painless way out was within reach. The search for treatments for her had led everywhere from neurologists to psychiatrists to psychics. Her illness was not fatal but seemed incurable and its cause was unknown. Or, perhaps more accurately, its cause was debated. Theda was suffering, but experts disagreed on why, and her right to sympathy hinged on the cause. If it was physical, she got compassion, exemptions, and affordable treatments. But if her condition was mental, she was a hysteric. Conversion disorder was the contemporary term for hysteria, and Theda had grappled with some doctors giving her that diagnosis, along with ones who adamantly told her it was something else. For a while, some doctors had said my sister had chronic fatigue syndrome. This had lasted 10 years. A new doctor had shifted her diagnosis to chronic Lyme disease in the last 3. As for me, I was uncertain. But it worried me that psychiatrists who said she had conversion disorder might be right. If they were, then the cause most likely came from our childhood. The racism we'd both experienced growing up hadn't been easy, but we'd also been torn between two parents from different cultures. One white and Western, one Eastern. Our father resented the white parts of us and had berated us for them growing up, whereas our mother had encouraged us to be Western, and the kids at school had bullied us for being too Asian. I'd always suspected my sister's illness was tied to our childhood troubles. But she and my mother disagreed, so I never said anything about it anymore. Theda was 37 and couldn't watch TV or use a computer. She barely ate any foods beyond the blandest ones I could imagine. She suffered migraines and nerve pain. She was so fatigued that all she did was lie in bed. And a few years ago, she had asked Mum and me for permission to die. We'd both given it, in our ways, Mum more directly than me, but the reality was much harder to comprehend now that the Nembutal was here. I glanced over at Mum. She looked pensive. Abstract thinking had never been her forte, but she was pragmatic and strong. She'd raised me with a working-class version of feminism that was deeply compassionate. "What about you?" she said. I eyed my cigarette. "Will you quit those?" "Soon," I said. "Any word from Rachel?" I shook my head. "How could anyone change their mind so quickly?" She looked at me for a moment longer, then slowly got up, leaving me on the front porch to my cigarettes and the June weather. 18 months earlier, while doing aid work in Thailand, I had met an American woman. When we met, I was 34 and she was 24. We fell in love and returned to Perth. The plan was to stay for a year, but ultimately move to the US and get married. After a year in Australia, she said she wanted another year, so we began applying for an Australian de facto visa that would allow her to keep working. The application documents were in a lever arc file on our coffee table, ready to go. But a few days before it was due, she changed her mind and flew back to her mother's house in Albany, New York. Rachel's childhood had been different to mine, and perhaps for that reason, I didn't fully comprehend her reasoning, but it had something to do with ambition and my inability to lubricate hers. Her mother, Mary Devison, had visited us 4 months before Rachel's turn and made her feelings clear. I wasn't good enough for her daughter's future. I remembered bringing Mary tea after her long flight from New York to Perth. She was a bespectacled blonde woman in her 50s with a slight hunch. Her suitcase was still unopened in the corner of our lounge room, and I had 3 cups and some biscuits on a tray. Rachel asked her how the family dog was going. "Oh, honey," Mary said, scrunching up her face. "Oh, darling. Oh, he was..." She looked up at me as I approached, holding the tray. "It was just so important that I come and talk to you about these..." She looked at me again and then at her daughter. "These decisions you're making. He needed so much care and no one could look after him. Your brother has college and your father, well, you know, his job is high stress. It was too important that I come and talk to you about..." She glanced at me again. "When I see you making mistakes, honey, I put him down." In bed that night, Rachel cried. "I did warn you," she said. "She's a bit nuts." "She killed the dog?" I said, trying to make sense of it. "Because she wanted to come and talk you out of marrying me?" Rachel looked at me with troubled eyes. "He was getting old anyway," she said. I breathed a sigh of relief when it was time for Mary to leave. "She commanded me home," Rachel said at the airport after her mother had passed through the gate. "While you were in the toilet, she said to me, 'Rachel, I am your mother, and I command you to come home right now.'" I didn't want to cause trouble, so I shrugged it off. Rachel had told me not to worry about her mother. She was going to marry me no matter what, and her mother didn't control her. I'd taken that at face value, and it never occurred to me that I was already in battle and needed to fight. For the next 2 months, Rachel and I talked about her grad school plans for the following year, when we planned on returning to her country. We talked about what we might name our children one day, and which small towns in America we might move to. Her anxiety flared up, but she told me it wasn't a big deal, and I encouraged her to take medication if that helped. She was happy otherwise, and I figured it wasn't anything major. She said she was delighted with everything in our lives and didn't really know why she was anxious, but that sometimes it just happened. And then, 8 weeks ago, she left me. She'd not been very aware of whatever was going on either, because a week before that, she'd taken my mother out for lunch to discuss wedding plans. I'd spoken to Mum on the phone afterwards, and she'd talked about how excited Rachel was. I think Rachel didn't know she was leaving me until the day before she did. The week before, she'd asked me to start organizing a party to announce our engagement to friends. A few days before she left me, she put up post-it notes around the apartment stuck to the insides of cupboards with little messages saying things like, "I love you, Kindle. I can't wait to spend the rest of my life with you. I never thought I'd be so lucky." She was like that, prone to cute acts of loving expression that were childlike, and I appreciated it. I was the same. Then she was gone. We spoke on Skype once she was back in America. Her reasons seemed thin and hastily assembled, as though she was trying to string together a clearer explanation in her own mind too. "I was hiding my mental health problems," she said. "I panicked. Mom was sending emails telling me I was ruining my life. It just got too much, worrying about whether she was right." "Can we save us?" "Yes," she said. "Come here, and we can sort it out. It'll be like we planned, just a year early." I should have gone straight away, but I felt obligated to finish the semester's teaching. My family needed time for me to say goodbye, and I had to get rid of the apartment I was renting. It took 4 weeks, and we spoke on Skype every day. Rachel seemed fine, and I was careful not to rock the boat. I wanted to talk about what had happened to make her leave so unexpectedly, but figured we might have better conversations in person. Then, a week ago, she changed her mind again. "What do you mean?" I said over Skype, after she had announced it. "In my field," she said, "in social justice, I can't have this amazing career if I'm married to someone like you. I just can't." "Why not?" "You don't earn enough money, Khin. You're an English second language teacher, and that might be enough in Australia, but here it won't work. I want a baby one day, and a career in this really competitive industry. Social justice work is hard to get, you know that. When we have kids, I'll need you to support me for a while. I don't think you'll be able to do it."
"But we always talked about raising children like a modern couple," I said.
"That's not realistic, Khin. My mother has been alive longer than either of us and talked to me about it really seriously. I get that it's upsetting, but we have to face reality."
"Did your mother..." "My mother knows me, Khin," she snapped.
"We went to a dance performance together last night. It was just... It was awesome, Kindle."
"You should have..."
She hesitated at the irony. I could see her getting excited via our Skype connection as she remembered. It was as if she was manic. "They were at the top of their field, Khin. From New York City. It's just, things are so different here. I'm more myself now, and the way their bodies were extensions of their minds, it... I can't explain. It was just..." She paused, still searching for words to describe this dance performance's importance. "Mom was talking to me in the theater bar afterwards, and I realized that I could be just like those dancers, in my own way, in social justice. But not if I marry you, because you're going to hold me back, Kindle. You really are. I'm very sorry. I still love you, but I need to do this."
"I'll come," I said, "so we can talk in person." I can't explain what happened next. I witnessed it, but it didn't make any sense to me. Her mood suddenly switched, and she began screaming incoherently. Spittle was coming out of her mouth and landing on the webcam. She was imploring me not to come, but more than that, she was also insulting me and swearing, calling me names and saying I was threatening her. "Just be a man, Khin," she yelled amid a tirade of other jumbled and confusing phrases. "Just be a fucking man." That was the week my sister's euthanasia drug arrived. I had no job and nowhere to go. So I took up smoking again, an old habit, and accepted Mum's offer to move home. I put out my cigarette and went inside, where I saw Mum was in the kitchen. I slipped quietly down the hallway to my sister's door and knocked. "Come in," she whispered. When I opened the door, her room was dark and cool. Opaque curtains covered the window, and the only light was a soft blue glow coming from an air filter that made silhouettes out of the furniture. Photo frames in the bookcase held images I couldn't quite make out. Mum had been given money for a humidity-controlling air conditioner a couple of years back, so the climate inside hadn't changed since I'd last entered. "Sorry," I said. "What for?" "I've been smoking, I stink." "It's okay," she said, patting the bedclothes. Do you want to listen to my audiobook? Her figure on the bed was slender and fragile. Once she'd been vivacious, now she was withered like an old lady. We hugged, and I retired to the armchair near the bottom of her bed. She often just wanted company rather than conversation. If talking was too tiring, we usually listened to a story. This one sounded somewhere in its middle, about an intergalactic space-traveling race searching for a new home. I sensed Theda settling back down, and my thoughts returned to Rachel. The audiobook narrator droned in the background as I thought of how Rachel had said something about wanting a rougher lover. We talked again after she calmed down following the last call, when she told me to be a fucking man. She spoke again about my masculinity and how it was more incompatible with her desires than I'd ever imagined. She talked about wanting a much more dominant guy in the bedroom. I'd thought our sex life was good until then. She'd always come during sex until the last couple of months when her medication made it difficult. She also told me that I didn't believe in her, which made no sense to me. "What do you mean?" I said. "Someone who sees my true potential wouldn't have let me stay in Australia when it was wrong for me," she said. When I reminded her that she'd been the one wanting to stay an extra year in Australia, she shifted gears again. "Someone right would know what I need. Someone right for me would have seen I needed to go back to America, even if I couldn't see that myself."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.